I'm closing the phone. No, hold the phone. Let us share the screen. Since I am the first one. Host disabled the participant. Can you enable it? You should all. Yeah, please. 9 participants already come in. Can I? See how it is. Thank you. Is my face
visible?
No. Nothing to do with presentation. Video, audio, and presentation are independent. Okay, so great today. Everything is working. You are, I hope you have done a trial with Harish. Anyway, there are people asking for admitting. That is supposed to be done by you. Thank you.
Hello, Rater Rater Rater.
Products also, technology is improving all the time. Their applications are improving all the time. And last but not the least is creating awareness through such webinars and workshops, and which was kickstarted in June with one of the global leaders in automation and digitization. And we want to have it nationally. Very soon we will have a platform which can also be connected to YouTube Live for free webinars. and Zoom with a bigger capacity for paid webinars. And we have many subsectors. I will talk about that very soon. And today, what are the major takeaways in my mind? Harsh, I'm still getting that screen, which is really bothering me. The major takeaways for this webinar is, at least in my mind, sixfold. What are the mechatronics and factory automation products and applications and solutions by companies like Festo? What are the unique applications, best practices in various manufacturing sectors by Festo? Festo is serving products across several sectors. I think our speaker will talk about that. What are the smart automation solutions? Smart means using internet. The word smart means digitalized using internet, like a Ola car, like a Uber car, like Swiggy and Zomato. What are the smart automation solutions? Like we say smartphone. Why do we say smartphone? It is taking the intelligence from the human being to the phone. The intelligence has gone to the phone. The phone is intelligent. The phone is smart. That is how the smart concept has come. And what are the training methodologies of courses by Festo in general? And what are the training solutions by Festo for smart manufacturing? Smart manufacturing and digital manufacturing. Manufacturing technologies using internet. And what are the digitized products? Festo is a great company in pneumatics, hydraulics, and factory automation solutions. They are digitizing all these existing products, which were so far run with electrical and electronics, to enable them with Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, internet, and so on and so forth. So I will not talk about all this. Our speakers will talk about all this. Now, who are our speakers? Our number one speaker, Ashwin Monikar sir, thank you very much for joining. If you can appear on the video, it will be great. Mr. Ashwin Monikar, you disappeared from the video.
No, I am already there on the video.
Yeah, the video now you come on the video. Now you come on the video. Well, I think there is a screen which is hiding me. I'm sorry. Mr. Ashwin Monikar, he is the head of India of Festo. That is nothing but the application division. He has graduated from Saurashtra University, Gujarat in mechanical engineering. He studied German language and went to Germany for further studies, did his master's in machine tool engineering at Technical University of West Berlin with specialization in automation technology. Who can be a better person than Mr. Ashwin Monikar to today talk about automation? After completion of master's in Berlin, he worked with Festo Germany for a few months before his posting in India. And his first responsibility in 1997, 23 years back, with Festo India was a regional sales manager. That means he worked very closely with the customers in Gujarat. From 2012 to 2015, he assumed the responsibility of head of Asia Pacific, which means India up to Australia, for industry segment for food and packaging. Many of the Festo solutions in automation are served in food and packaging industry. Since 2016, he has been the head of application engineering for Cluster India. He will probably explain to us what is Cluster India. And he has been working in Festo for 23 years. Welcome, Mr. Ashwin.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chandramouli.
Yes, we have a great speaker today, Mr. Harish Nachnani. He is in charge of Festo Didactic. There is a separate website of Festo called www.festo.com for the main business of Festo. There is another website, festodidactic.de or .com, I think. And that Mr. Harish can share later on through Capital Goods Council, that nothing but training division of Festo. The didactic is the methodology of imparting training. He also did his engineering, electrical engineering from Gujarat University. I'm sorry. He did his master's in business administration from Pune University. For 22 years of experience in sales and marketing, business development, project management, and cloud services. Underline cloud services, internet. And in education segment, he has been there for many, many years. Before Festo, he worked in Cable Corporation of India, Rittal India, which is a German company, Aconex, which is part of Oracle as we are talking. And he is now responsible for the education and training solutions of the head of didactic at Festo India. So both the speakers I have introduced briefly, and we will now have a quick briefing of what Capital Goods Council. Right, I happen to be a general council member, GC member, and also convener of Industry 4.0 Task Force of the Capital Goods Skill Council, and also now looking after as a convener of the Atmanirbhar Bharat webinar series. Atmanirbhar Bharat, as you all know, is introduced. Atmanirbhar series was introduced by the term Atmanirbhar Bharat was introduced by none other than our Prime Minister, Mr. Modi, Honorable Prime Minister. And we just borrowed the adjective Atmanirbhar Bharat. But our webinar is being a very small contribution to the self-reliant India. Now, the objectives of setting up the Sector Skill Council is manifold. I don't want to waste time on this. Suffice to say, we are the governing body for skilling in India. We are part of Skill India movement. We are part of Skill to Scale and Speed. We want to spread it across the country in 10 subsectors: machine tool subsector, metal forming subsector, foundry and forging subsector, textile machinery subsector, plastic machinery subsector, process equipment subsector, construction machinery subsector, electrical equipment subsector, material handling equipment subsector, and automation equipment subsector. Today, I think many of you who are participating today have come from many of these sectors. 200 people enrolled, but obviously others are busy. 92 people have logged in so far. This council is a governing body looking at national occupational standards for skilling to find out the content and curriculum and the infrastructure required to deliver the skilling through training partners. The council itself does not deliver the training, but it delivers through approved training partners. And it promotes academies of excellence who are there in the country, and we are tying up with all of them. It also finds a demand and supply for the various skills required in this country across these 10 subsectors. And it promotes apprenticeship across these sectors of various category of skills. It conducts a skill competition for India skill competition and world skill competition. And above all, in the corona period, you must know, we have to be online. So we develop online learning content. It's called the e-skilling mission. And the council was promoted by Department of Heavy Industries, government, FICCI, which is a body of private public body, membership of the industries across the country, and supported by National Skill Development Council Corporation, National Skill Development Corporation. So our mother body is National Skill Development Corporation. There are 34 skill council. Capital Goods Sector Skill Council is one of them. Now, I don't want to get into the details. There are many associations as part of the council. There are many public sector organizations as part of this council as members. And there are many private sector organizations as part of the council. And there are many multinational corporations as part of the council in the governing body. The governing body itself has got around 17 to 18 members who are steering this council from 2013 onwards. Now, this council has accredited more than 890 training partners across the country. And today, we are also looking at how to support government in bringing the migrant labor. The migrant labor are equally skilled than as opposed to the regular labor in our factories. Except that we call them contract workmen or whatever. But without them, industries cannot survive. So we are trying to retrain the migrant labor through our national apprenticeship scheme. And Capital Goods Council is playing a major role through the 896 training partners across the country. There are many, many achievements. I don't want to go into great detail. 55 skill qualifications and 96 national occupation standards have been approved and accredited by the council over the last 5 years. It also includes 2 qualifications under Industry 4.0. I'll briefly touch upon it in a few moments. 94,000 people have been trained and assessed. 67,000 people have been certified. 893 training partners and 463 assessing partners. Training partners are not same as assessing partners, because somebody imparts training, somebody has to check whether the trainee has acquired the skill and the knowledge. There are 15 designated training centers for the trainers. We also look after the trainers and the instructors. There are 10 designated centers of excellence. We are aligned with the state government. In the national skill development, world skill competition, awards have been won by people. You can see in Russia, this young boy won the award. The area of which his area is welding. And of course, many participants from CNC milling, CNC turning, design, plastic die engineering and welding. More than 12 to 15,000 registrations even this year. Thanks to COVID, it is slightly slowing down. So this is a world scale competition. Apprenticeship scheme, there are many points. I don't want to get into that. People can log in to the website of Capital Goods Council and then go to the National Skill Development Corporation website. And you can log in and ask for what kind of role you can play. And we tie up with opportunities. So it is almost like an employment exchange. In those days, we call it employment exchange. And now we call it as an apprenticeship scheme where opportunities are created and contracts are fulfilled for job various job roles. Now coming to my mission, what we are doing in this council is Industry 4.0 technologies. Some of you are very familiar, artificial intelligence, additive manufacturing, augmented reality, system integration, cloud-based application, simulation solutions, Internet of Things, and industrial robots. Big data analytics. These are just some of the technologies which are come under the umbrella of Industry 4.0. And we have created a list inventory of related to the Industry 4.0. Examples are additive manufacturing technologies, design for additive manufacturing, advanced data analytics scientists, and so on and so forth. Now there are 20 to 30 types of roles, of which we have prioritized 10 job roles. Factory automation. I'm not able to remove this. Harsh, there is something blocking my screen, which says, please move this window away from the shared application.
Sir, I'm also trying the same, but it is not happening from my side also.
No. It is really bothering me. And it will bother the two speakers. Okay, by the way, are you recording whatever we are talking?
Yes, sir, we are recording.
Right. Factory automation engineer, digital manufacturing engineer, predictive maintenance engineer, digital quality engineer, and digital maintenance. We call it as a predictive maintenance also. And apart from that, there are many support functions. Augmented reality is an extremely important job role. Thanks to the COVID, it is really helping across the country, across the world, to do the work without having too many people in the factory or in the site of maintenance. And especially in places like very dangerous and difficult to reach, mining industry and places like thermal stations, power generation, oil and gas industry, and so on and so forth, or started using augmented reality specialist. So, and these jobs will be paying very well. People, when they pick up these skills, they'll be like a premium for the industry. And there are not many people already in the country. And we are creating the skill requirements and the concepts and training. I request all the participants to mute their mic and write their questions in the chat box. And at the end of this program, we have got enough time to address the questions. Now, many webinars have been conducted by Capital Goods Council across the country. And I thank you so much for your patient listening. And I now request the organizers to hand over the screen. I welcome our speakers one by one. I think we are first, Mr. Ashwin is going ahead with that. Before Mr. Nachnani, yeah, we will be having the first speaker, Mr. Ashwin Wanikar. Welcome, sir. And
thank
I hope
you very much.
Mr. Harsh will now help us to navigate through the rest of the session today. All participants, kindly put your questions on the chat box. And I will be here to handle that at the end of the session. The session will be minimum 1 hour by Mr. Ashwin and Mr. Nachnani. Very interesting session. And please don't go away from this webinar. Now we have crossed 102 people, including the speakers. Let's put a talia. We have crossed 100 people. Thank you very much, Mr. Ashwin. Go ahead, please.
Yeah.
Please share the screen with Mr. Ashwin.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Share the screen.
I will do stop share.
Yes, sir.
I have done stop share.
Host disable participant screen sharing.
Sir, that I have done, sir.
Okay, but I'm not able to share.
Sir, can you please try again one more time?
Okay.
Yes, sir, it is sharing. Yeah, the size of the screen is
visible.
Yeah, it is visible, but your size of the laptop screen is bigger. So some portion may get trimmed at the border. It's okay.
Okay.
We can start, sir. We can start.
Maybe my video, I'll stop my video because, yeah. My voice is audible?
No, yes, sir.
Sir, you don't need to stop the video. Keep the video on. We want to see your face.
Okay.
Speaker should always be visible to the audience.
Okay.
That is not the reason. Your screen, laptop screen, is set up at a wider width. Doesn't matter. I am able to see everything in your screen.
Okay. But
Go ahead, sir.
I'm seeing lot of patch at the bottom, the disturbance. How to take
that
it
will
up?
Come. That is a problem with that Zoom platform.
Okay.
And we can't help it, sir. Also has suffered. You can move that to the down.
Down.
You can't hide that toolbox. The toolbox cannot be hidden.
Yeah. Now it's done. Only on the top something is there. See waiting room.
Sir, don't worry about that thing. I will manage that.
Okay. The waiting room is issues caused by Harsh.
Okay.
There is a CGSC problem.
Fine.
I also was irritated by that. Kindly go ahead, sir.
Okay. So good morning, everybody, ladies and gentlemen. If there are ladies also in the group. My name is Ashwin Manikar. I have already been introduced by Mr. Chandramouli. And I thank CGSC for giving FESTO an opportunity to share some of the latest things which are happening. And today's topic is extremely important. And on 12th May, it was a special day for India where our Honorable Prime Minister, Mr. Shri Narendra Modi ji, he gave a complete new concept to India, Atmanirbhar Bharat. And now we have to see how we take it further. We as an industry group, how we have to take this further, what we can, how to take this further, and how automation can help India in sustaining and in further improvement and further development of this Atmanirbhar Bharat concept, or I would say a complete value addition, what can be done from the industry, especially industry like FESTO, who are also into the automation, what we can do for that. As you can see my content, first we will go through a video which would be a question not only to me but also to the industry, that are we ready for digitalization? Are we ready for that? Then we'll have a small journey into the FESTO, so FESTO at a glance. Then we will see what is FESTO's digital strategy, the smart products. Today everybody is looking for efficient production, the efficient components, the smart products, how we will do that, what FESTO is doing into that. In that direction. For Industry 4.0, what are the concepts developed by FESTO? What are the first steps like IO-Link? That also we'll go through that. Then there are some very special topics which are new to the world where I call it motion terminal. Definitely we'll take a small journey into that also in the later part of the presentation. And then something special which is again on the digital level, the smart conveyors, right? So let me go through a small video which will ask the group a question, that are we ready? Are you ready for digitalization? I hope that this video is visible and audible both.
Are you ready? Ready to persist in a world that turns faster and faster, where everything becomes less predictable. finds a partner that is close to you, wherever you are. We are ready. With the expansion of manufacturing and logistic facilities around the globe, we doubled our production capability in the last 2 years. This ensures high volumes and reliable delivery performance.
Ashwin, you can increase the volume. You can increase the volume in your laptop.
The upcoming complexity of your customer demands. With our proven experience in industrial automation, we are ready to support you from designing to operating your machine with the best technological solution and the most competitive product range ever. Are you ready for the most challenging price battles in the future? With our new core product range, we enable you to be competitive without compromising quality. We are ready. Ready for you.
Yeah, so that was a quick journey into that, whether the industry is ready, whether we are ready. And now you have seen that Festo can deliver a complete range of the solutions, not only the product, but the solutions, which, as it clearly said, that not compromising on the quality, right? So this is where that what is the direction of Festo, where it will take for the future production. Now coming to the some slides of corporate presentation, we know that Festo is a, and maybe some people may know it, or some may not be aware of it, that Festo is a family-oriented company with a turnover of 3.2 billion euro worldwide. We have almost more than 300,000 customers. We are serving in 176 countries as far as after sales is concerned, almost 250 branch offices. We have set the standards in the industrial automation technology, not only in the industrial automation technology, but also in the education sector, where Mr. Harish Nathnari will speak further on that when it comes to didactic. So this is what Festo is today. We are present in 61 countries. That is what the presence of Festo is. So it's really a global company serving to the customers' needs for automation, industrial automation. Our portfolio for automation is, we provide the customers of all key industries with the right products and excellent services, both in factory and process automation, as Mr. Chandramouli initially said. Of course, I am from the factory automation, so I will not be speaking much on the process automation. We have the pneumatic and the electric portfolio. Now, what is this electric portfolio? We'll see the later slide, because when it comes to Festo, people know it's a blue color, and when it is blue color, people are trying to relate it with pneumatics. And when it comes to pneumatics and pneumatics automation. But Festo in last few years, maybe last few decades, has completely changed the image from pneumatic automation to electric automation. Now what that is, of course, today in this forum, we'll not be talking too much in details about that, but definitely I will give you the glimpse about when we say Festo is moving away, or Festo is also adding a lot of portfolios, a lot of technologies, to the pneumatic automation, which is completely different direction of electric automation. So you can see almost more than 30,000 catalog products. We have more than 10,000 individualized solutions specially developed for the customers. We have the customer solutions. That means they are completely built up customized units, so that the customer need not assemble on his own. It is pre-designed, pre-assembled and pre-tested unit, which goes to the customer as a plug and work solution, right? Of course, faster deliveries, because almost a lot of products are available off the shelf, not only in India, but globally also. So this is what is the portfolio for the factory. Is somebody speaking in between? Yeah, okay. Automation strength in various industry segments. Festo caters to a lot of industry segments. The prime industry segments I would like to mention here are the automotive industry, the machine tool industry. Of course, we consider machine tool industry more for the automotive industry. So it's the part of that for us when we are catering to automotive industry. Food and packaging. When Mr. Chandramouli, when he introduced me, I was the head of Asia Pacific for 4 years for food and packaging. It's a division which we know which never will have any ups and downs. There are no fluctuations, no spikes, ups and downs. Whatever happens to the industry, food and packaging, we consider pharmaceutical also as a part of food and packaging. So food and packaging industry will never have much spikes, ups and downs because everybody needs to eat. Everybody needs to have a nice packaged food. So those industry will always thrive whenever other industries even are down. So that is not a problem. We are also serving to the electronic industry. We are serving the new industry segments which are now developing, which we saw during the COVID-19 is the life tech industry or the medical and the laboratory automation, where ventilators are to be developed or where some other products are developed for the COVID-19 patients. So we are helping those also industries to develop those type of systems, and we give solutions for those systems also. Because mostly they are oxygen related systems, where Festo has also given a big contribution during the COVID-19 development of this type of devices. Our range of solutions and services for the industry. When we talk about the services, we also are, which is again a topic which may not be, many people may not be aware about it, that we are into services like we do the energy audit at the customers, whether their systems are functioning well, whether there are leakages in the system, whether the consumption of the air is very high, whether the consumption of electrical energy is very high. So we literally do an energy audit at the customer, mostly at the end users, whenever it is required. And then we give the report that this is the saving, where the savings can be done. And then at the end of the report, customer knows this is the saving per day or per year for me. And then it's really a good service which we are offering to the customer. Coming to the individual solutions, these are the day in and day out job of what Festo is doing as a solution provider, that we use complete solutions, not only the product. We don't encourage our customers to buy our product. We give solutions to the customer. Ready to install solutions is nothing but plug and play, which I mentioned earlier, that we can build a complete system. It could be in form of control cabinet. Of course, in the later slides, I will come to that point. That these are the solutions where the customer need not have the headache of designing, selecting everything on his own, because it lands in his premises as a complete workable and plug and play solution. They just have to add the connect the electrical wire and the tube and the pneumatic tube, and it starts functioning. Only they have to make a space on their machine to mount that. Training and consulting, when I talk about myself as a factory automation person, me and my team member, they do a lot of trainings and consulting on the factory automation. But of course, we, as I said, Mr. Harish Nathnani will be also speaking on the didactic part of that, which is again a big part of training and consulting what the didactic division in Festo does. Most of the customers, the heading of the slide, it is not given by Festo. Most of the customer, the market sees Festo as a one-stop solution provider for factory automation, where you can see that we have on X and Y axis the value-added solutions, and we have the customer benefits. So as I said, we encourage the customers to buy and to try to get the ready-to-install solutions or plug-and-work solutions, but it's not that Festo compels the industry or the market. We also have the individual catalog components or the products which some people require, and we sell them also. The second step is that we sell certain products in part of modular products. Then we have the individual modules where not only the pneumatics, but electronic and the digitized part is also the part of that solution. As a complete plug and work, we also are encouraging the customers to go for a complete control cabinet solutions, which are individually configured for each and every industry segment or each and every different customer. Then we have the handling. Of course, people know the robots, people know the SCARA robot, people know the articulated robots, but Festo doesn't manufacture those type of robots, but we also do the robotic motions through our own handling axis, which we call them the Cartesian robots. So that is also one art of robot, which is much more accepted in the industry for the handling solutions to satisfy the needs of the customers. Now, slowly I'm moving toward the digitalized topic. Festo is a leader supplier of automation technology and technical solutions to the industry. Going digital is an integral part of our corporate strategy. Now, why that? How do we do that? So with that, we are pursuing four goals, which you can see here. We want to increase the productivity of ourselves and of our customers, definitely. We want to offer the value-added services to the customer. We want to secure the growth of the customer. And we want to expand our innovation leadership. That is for sure, right? And this is what the roadmap, or would say the digitalization strategy of is to mean here. Coming now slowly towards the main topic, that what smart product, what do we do? Why do we call it smart? And what type of products can we offer to the industry? When we are now talking of Atmanirbhar Bharat, Atmanirbhar Bharat cannot happen without automation. And the automation of the past was different, where it was happening, as Mr. Chandramouli rightly said, it was just mainly simple circuits or simple programming or this thing. Now, when we are talking about adding or strengthening the Atmanirbhar Bharat automation with the digitalization, there has to be something more, something extra, some extra value addition which should go along with that. So which is the digitalization in automation for Atmanirbhar Bharat. Without that, we will not be able to fulfill that that value of Atmanirbhar Bharat for sure. Talking about the smart products, which are okay in the direction of Industry 4.0, the IoT gateways, and then we talk about the cloud, then we talk about the big data and all these things. There are also, but let us some talk about also set out some of the basic things which are required for this type of solutions, which are again equipped with digitalization. So energy efficiency is a big topic in the industry today. I will come to that in the next slide. Individually configurable products, as I said, the Festo products are more of the modular type. So whatever the customer needs or whatever we want to suggest to the customer to fulfill his application or his needs in automation can be configured. It is so modular and can be easily configured as per the need of the application or as per the demand of the application. Festo Motion Terminal is a big topic. It's a complete new way of how the pneumatics, which was considered as whether it will remain or whether it will die in the future. Now, how that has been strengthened with digitalization is a big thing to know. Everybody should know about it, that there is a big thing going on in the digitalization of pneumatics. Nobody would have imagined otherwise. When we talk about the digitalization, we think about the electronics which can be digitalized or other things and electricals which can be further digitalized. But how the pneumatics can be digitalized, that we are going to see today, right? So talking about the first thing, what we talk in the pneumatics automation is the air preparation, but I'm not going to talk about air preparation because many people know what is being done in air preparation, but definitely I'm going to talk about that. When we talk about the air today, each and every big end user, whether it is automotive industry or food industry or packaging industry or textile industry or electronic industry, carbon footprint reduction, it is a big topic. It is a big headache for each and everyone. How can I reduce? How can I minimize the leakages? How can I reduce when my machine is in standstill condition? How can I minimize the leakages? How can I minimize the consumption of the air? And exactly this topic, this slide, what it shows is a unit called the MS6E2M, which is an energy efficiency module, which is completely digitally equipped. And that's why it is digitally monitoring what is happening about the air. So there are three functions what it can do. One is when the machine is in standby, it detects that. So the intelligence is already now, when we talk about the IoT or when we talk about the Industry 4.0, main thing is how intelligent is each and every device in the path for that automation, how smart it is, whether the intelligence is built in into that device. Not only that the PLC, the master PLC is governing everything, but the device itself inherently should be equipped with that intelligence. And exactly this intelligence is built into this device. It detects that the machine is not functioning the way it should. It's not the regular intervention. This is in standby mode. It switches off itself. The second is detection of the leakages. That when the machine is in standby mode, it could be lunchtime, it could be the shift change. And if at all there are undetectable leakages for a human being or for any other device, this device has that intelligence built in It detects the leakages maybe for 5 seconds, 10 seconds, that is again adjustable. And then it knows that this is an abnormal air which is going through this. This is not the regular air, and it has that intelligence to switch off that so the air consumption can be stopped. And then this is one contribution towards the reduction of the carbon footprint today. Other big thing is many companies, they would like to monitor what is my air consumption, whether I can data login of the air during this time, whether in the first shift, why it is consuming more, whether the night shift is consuming less or less. So depending upon that, they can monitor, they can have the data logging of this air consumption, everything on their record. And this can be, again, via IoT devices, can be stored on the cloud. So this is possible. And as you can see at the bottom of the slide, that this device is also can be equipped with the latest, all the communication protocols, mostly which are available on the market, whether it is Ethernet IP or Profibus or Profinet or EtherCAT, right? And with a quite huge flow rate, it can cater to almost any big machine on a production hall. That is possible. When we talk about the pneumatics, we also should talk about the valves. Now, I'm not going to talk about the conventional valve technology, which was wired individually or which had multi-pin. No. Now, even that valve terminal, when we call it valve, some people call it valve island, or we call it valve terminal, how the digital technology has equipped and made it much more stronger to work for the automation. And this is exactly where it is the topic, where how it would strengthen the value of Atmanirbhar Bharat, right? Today we talk about not only the simple valve terminals, with wire technology is also now equipped with the complete digitized technology. It can be equipped with the field bus nodes, especially when there are two concepts today we are talking about. One is a centralized installation where the machines are smaller. So on a single valve module, you can see on the left side of the, you can see the complete digitized modules which have IO links and PLC, or which can be equipped with the field bus nodes. On the right side is a valve terminal, which is a pneumatic valve terminal. So this is equipped with this technology where it can do the function, a standalone function for a complete automation process. The biggest advantages or benefits are 60% more efficient, because a lot of functions, you need not go for external pressure sensors. You need not go for external proportional pressure regulators. Everything can be mounted on this. And that's why we say, because the functional integration can be done on this particular device, which is highly automated and intelligent for any automation task, right? The second technology, which is also used in the industry, is a decentralized installation system. Especially this comes in the picture where the machines are extremely wide, extremely long, and then you, in the centralized automation, you cannot cater to those machines where the automation devices are spreaded across 20 meter, 30 meter, 50 meter. And we cannot have a centralized PLC, or we cannot have a centralized valve terminal to cater to those cylinders or to those drives which are 20 meter, 30 meter, 50 meter away. So that's why decentralized installation systems are there, right? Where you can see the on the right, left side, what you see is everything mounted on one single module. On the right side, what you see that all are being now spaced across widely around the machines where the devices are actually doing the motions. So we have the decentralized or spreaded out valve terminals with the IO modules, right? And the main PLC or the field bus modules nodes are directly mounted on one. So single wire is communicating to those modules, but this is the major, and the benefit of this is that all this technology is very near to the working actuators, the operating actuators. So the cycle time reduction is there by almost 30%. Because they are now very near to the devices, the air consumption also gets reduced because the tubing lengths are small by almost 50%. And we save a lot of space on building a control cabinet and all these things that is not required, because those are all individualized devices where we took a talk about in the digitizing the remote IOs, right? So these are the remote IOs which are decentralized, which are spread across the machine, so that we save on wiring, we save on tubing, we save on the energy consumption of the air. Now slowly we move towards.
Sorry to interrupt. There are some people talking. There are some people talking. They have to mute now, please. You have to respect the speaker.
Some disturbance is coming. Yeah.
Just hold on, sir.
Sir, I have muted everybody.
So don't mute the speaker.
Thanks, Harsh. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Thank you.
So now, of course, Industry 4.0 was a buzzword 2.5 years ago in the Indian market scenario. Now it is no more a buzzword. And when we are talking of Industry 4.0, we have to consider, it comprises mainly of the products. So that's why we talk about the physical systems, which are the products or the devices. Of course, a human intelligence is built in, which will further take on to the artificial intelligence and all those things. So human intelligence is definitely a big contributor to the Industry 4.0. Communication devices, as I talked about that even in the previous phase, that there are so many communication different modules, there are so many platforms available for communicating, and of course the networking. So when we talk about the Internet of the Things and Internet, you know, industrial Internet of the Things, we are talking of the networking. Why? Because now this is not a localized topic of a production hall. It goes beyond the borders. It goes beyond the borders of the country. It goes beyond the borders of the continents, where the machines are running somewhere else. We are monitoring, we are governing the machines and parameterizing the machines from any place of the world, any location of the world. And that's why it requires a powerful networking, which is the part of the Industry 4.0. Of course, what can be the outcome of the Industry 4.0? Right? Then we have so many value-added services which can be done through that. It is analysis, where we talk about the big data and the cloud service. We talk about the condition monitoring. Industry 4.0 will also give as a sub-product that how even different business models can be routed through the Industry 4.0. So for example, pay-per-user. So I just give an example. Let's say if I want to reach my office on time, and if there is a traffic, there are so many traffic lights in between, why can't I pay an extra money and I have a dedicated route which always gives me a green signal, right? So that is the part of the different business models which will come up or which will crop up because of the Industry 4.0. Predictive maintenance, online through networking, customer support, sitting anywhere in the part of the world, that can be easily done, right? So now, when we're talking of the cyber physical systems, where I talked about the physical devices, I talked about the cyber this thing, where we're talking of the communication and the networking. And initially I said that why can't the intelligence now in Industry 4.0, we cannot talking about only a PLC. We have to talk about the smartness or what we put inside a product, how much smartness and what type of smartness we put inside an individual product. You can see here a simple pneumatic cylinder of Festo with the sensors, with the valves. So what smartness can be put into this valve that they can take a decision on their own? Now, this is where we would go for the that right direction for the Industry 4.0, that all the devices in the system, they have to be smart enough. They have to be equipped with the self-intelligence. So they decide on their own when a different batch or a different product. Because here when we are talking of the manufacturing, we are not talking of only a batch manufacturing or a bulk manufacturing. Even for a single product, the machines automatically, they have to adjust to that particular need, what is there for the customer, even coming for a one single item, one single product. Right? How we can be a partner for a smart factory? So let's say there are different devices. One of the devices which I have named here is the CPXE, is an electronic or the digital platform. So I talked about the remote IOs which are there, which are completely on the digital platform, which are communicating, and you can see all the devices on the path. We have the safety devices, we have in the field, on the production hall, we have the controllers, we have the valve terminals, then we have the remote IOs, which are best solution for the decentralized solutions. And then now we are talking slowly of the language called the IO link product. I will talk about that also in the next slide. And now the communication through that. And then there can be other systems which are the part of automation today. We cannot think about an automation today without the vision system, right? What a human naked eye can see and detect, the same intelligence, the same smartness also has to be built into the vision system, what we are talking about, the vision camera, right? And now those type of intelligent cameras, smart cameras are available on the market, which can detect anything what a human eye may not be even able to detect. To that extent, the smartness has been pumped into those vision systems. Now, all this talking, they are talking through that. I talked about certain platforms called the OPC UA, which everybody knows is a software interface which is capable of not only transporting the machine data, like process values, measurements, and all these things, but is also capable of semantically describing them in the machine readable format, right? Now, let's say when we have for one particular production, if we have a machine from different supplier, one may be going for EtherCAT, the other may be going for Profibus, the other may be going for CC-Link. All these different platforms cannot communicate with each other. Today, because of the OPC UA, which is a common platform designed and decided and defined for the industry 4.0, will be the solution of the future industry 4.0. Right, and then of course, all through that, through the IoT gateways, everything can be stored on the server, which is a cloud, the big data, and then we can do anything with that. We can do the analysis of that. We can take the reports out of that. We can do the functional improvements in the further processes because of that. All that can be enabled through this type of topology or this type of architecture. Now coming to the very basics of that thing, that the first step towards Industry 4.0, according to me, are the IO-Link product. That was the first one which was described and defined for the Industry 4.0. Now, what is this different than the normal product? And let me take just an example of a pressure sensor. Today, what is happening that a customer on his machine, he's putting a pressure sensor, and that pressure sensor is being parameterized for certain things, let's say the minimum maximum pressure, a window, NO or NC. All these different parameters are being set on the pressure sensors manually. Now, with the ingression of or the encroachment of the IO-Link into those products, when the product is being strengthened and equipped with an IO-Link enabled devices, then first of all, IO-Link is not a typical bus protocol. It is mostly like a point-to-point serial two-way communication. Now, as I gave an example of the pressure sensor, today the pressure sensor was only able to communicate one way to the PLC. I have the pressure, so I have got the pressure, I will give you the signal, and then you start the machine. Now, that is not the need of the Industry 4.0. Let's say because of the batches, because of the differences in the production and those challenges, every time the data or the parameters on that devices have to be changed. Now, every time if there are so many pressure sensors, and pressure sensor is just one topic, one device, I'm talking of the flow sensors or even temperature sensors and all these things, right? On how many we go and then physically touch them and start changing those parameters and adjust, it's not practical. So through IO-Link, sitting in the office, we can download those data, because the moment the pressure sensor is once parameterized or taught in, PLC has the complete information because of the IO-Link. Now that information, PLC completely, it is aware about that complete information. And next time when there is a faulty pressure sensor and we replace that with a new one, we need not reparameterize everything. We need not teach in everything. PLC has the complete information. It can, the moment there is a device, it knows that a new device has been put in there, and PLC can completely download the data of that, of the previous device on the new one. So this is the beauty of the IO-Link, right? So change of device doesn't matter. First of all, we are saving a lot on the downtime, right? So when we are talking of the automation, we have to think about this, that how much downtime we can reduce, so that, because you know, in some kind of industry, especially automotive industry, every second is costing a few thousand rupees, a few hundred thousand rupees sometime, right? And then these are the devices which will save in reducing the downtimes. Some of the products which I talked about, which are equipped with the IO-Link, which is the first step towards the Industry 4.0. So we are talking about some of the electrical actuators. Now, what is the electrical? As I said, Festo has changed its image in the past decades from pneumatics to an electrical automation solution provider, right? So what cannot be satisfied with pneumatics, and we know pneumatics could have limitations, can be satisfied with the electrical devices. So we talk about the servo motors, we talk about stepper motors, we talk about the ball screw drives and all these things. You can see these are all equipped with this, but they are also equipped with IO-Link, which is the need of the industry 4.0. Even the flow sensors, the pressure sensors, the smart position transmitters, which are mounted on the pneumatic drives, the valve terminals. Today, people want to know the diagnostic of whether the valve is working or not, whether it is functioning or not, whether there is a short circuit in the coil or not. All these things need to be known, which was today was not possible because of the IO-Link. Now every data is available on the cloud. Now this is what I'm talking of, the devices which are for the electric automation, whether they are ball screw for high speed. We have even the tooth belt type, that means the timer belt type of devices. And the beauty is that these are all encased or encompassed into a housing where internally there is an LM guide. So customer need not mount anything. Of course, this is the part of the mechanics, but again, they have been equipped with the special digital items and also the IO-Link. So you can see these are very special type of motors, and you can see the drives are directly sitting on that. We don't require a motor controller or we don't require a motor drive separately to be mounted inside a control cabinet. And this is directly on that. This device for any motion, for any stroke wind, for any forces, for any payload can be directly parameterized pressing certain buttons on this device. So this is now the beauty, and this is exactly possible because this is now loaded with the digital technology. Coming to which I talked on the first slide, that we will be seeing also the plug and work solutions, that Festo doesn't encourage its customer or the market to go for the individualized product and do everything on their own, because we know that the demands on the market are increasing, not only from the technical point of view, not only from the technology point of view, but also from the timeline, the deadline point of view. Every customer is now being pressurized, is under pressure that my machine has to be supplied to the end user in certain this time. And the time frames are so challenging that customer doesn't have the time for his machine to make everything, to build everything, to assemble everything, put on the machine. It is not possible. So that's why we encourage more and more of the pre-assembled or plug-and-work solution. And some of the solutions you can see here, simple cylinder valve assembly, or a simple modular air preparation system, or simple panel where you can see there are pressure regulators, there are valve terminals, there are pressure sensors, there are air preparation units, a simple valve terminal, which is not only a valve terminal on the left side, which I explained in the centralized and decentralized installation system. The complete digital part is on the left side, which is governing these valves, which is communicating also with the devices, the right devices through OPC UA, through the IoT gateway, and the data goes to the cloud. Or the very complicated handling system for pick and place, where I talked about the robotics. Festo also is into robotics, but with its Cartesian robots, right? Of course, the control cabinet, that if somebody doesn't wants an enclosure and all these things, you can see certain motor controllers are built into the control cabinet with our safety, complete pre-wired, pre-designed, pre-tested, without any headache. Customer can directly mount it on his machine and can run the machine just like that. Now I'm coming towards the topic which I know that most of the audience, the participants, they are also from the machine tool industry. What we do for this industry. Of course, I am just correlating this topic with the plug-and-work solutions, because the blue shaded what you see is the part of the pre-assembled or ready-to-install solutions, and what is our scope in that, right? So whether it is a door automation, or whether it is the tool changer system, or whether it is an interlinking device, we will see in the later slide what all this is, right? Or whether it's a gripping and clamping devices, or whether it is a component loading devices, everything as a pre-assembled solution. Again, in the previous slide, before the pre-assembled and plug-and-work solution, we have seen that how everything is being equipped with the digitalization technology or the digitized technology, and how that will work on these devices, right? So for the machine tool, what we do, this industry, we have the interlinking system, again, equipped with the complete digital system with all PLC, with field bus node and everything. With IO-Link and with IoT gateway, everything, OPC UA, everything is possible to load those systems, which can be used as you can. It's not a new word for anybody. Interlinking systems are where you can connect multiple machines. Here I talk about the CNC machines for loading, top loading, or for interlinking for the pick and place of the component or loading of the component, unloading of the component from one machine to another. We are completely equipped with this technology. We have the handling devices which can handle a payload up to 150 kilo. So this is all possible today with the technology what is there. And needless to say, everything equipped with the same digitalization which I talked in the previous slides. Tool changer system, right? Everybody is interested in the ATC, the auto tool changing system, how that can be equipped. Of course, it will be run by the valve terminals, which are again digitized, which are already on the digital platform. They're not only now the valves, they're completely equipped with the digital system. But this is also a big topic for everybody, that how can I reduce my time of designing and selection, whether I can get something as a ready-made plug and work solution. So even the ATCs also are being pre-configured, selected, designed, and pre-tested before they go to the customer. So everything is possible here. I will share you one video of what we do in the... Just a second. I hope you can see the video. This is a complete pre-assembled, pre-tested unit. And you can see all the electronics, and I hope that we'll see. And this all is equipped with that digitalization, which will transfer the data, which will take the data through the IoT gateway, through OPC UA to the cloud. But main part is also to see that this is a pre-assembly. Even that portion of the digitalization where this machine is equipped with, which can, and you can see also the camera, you saw the QR codes. So it is also equipped with an intelligent and smart camera, which detects all the things, and accordingly it takes its own decision. That is extremely important. Coming to a very different unit, which I have put into this, maybe people from the machine tool industry, those who are catering also to some automotive sector, they might be knowing that there are balancers, we call it sometimes zero balancers, or the manipulators which are there in the industry to lift heavy loads. Heavy loads, when I say, it could be a car tire, it could be a car wheel, it could be a big tractor tire, which are almost 800, 900 kilo. So up to 999 kilo is not a problem for this. Now, till now, this new balancer were purely pneumatic balancers. So they only had a cylinder, a pneumatic cylinder, and then they were equipped with a simple pressure regulator, and then people were able to lift this for a particular load. The moment the load used to change, either it used to subtract, because now we have to put that load somewhere, or we have to add another load, or where there are variants of different payloads or different masses, it was not possible, because then you need multiple pressure regulators, or you need a special load cell to detect that. When you need a load cell, then you require a proportional pressure regulator. Now, all this has been equipped with the latest digital technology. So you can see everything is now added, what you see new, which is the part of, it is an intelligent valve unit, which is on a digital platform. You can see a special controller loaded with the software on this, and you can see a handle, whatever load is mounted on this, whether the load is subtracted or the load is added, nothing to be done. This device is so intelligent without any load cell. And believe me, there is no load cell mounted on this. It automatically detects when the load is changed. And that is that beauty and the intelligence and the smartness which has been put in this controller and this special valve, which detects that load, and then it acts and reacts accordingly, and then is absolutely stable and stationary. Moment the operator wants to lift it or lower it down, it reacts at that point. So this is the beauty of that. I will show you an animation of that what we do for the industry. Of course, these solutions and manipulators are mainly for handling the heavy object. It could be doors or panels or axles or tires or the batteries. So any machine tool or any line builder, if it is there in the audience, you can think about this type of solution, which is a highly smart and intelligent solution, a self-detecting solution for the industry. I'll just run the video. You will have a better idea. So you can see the person is just lifting the handle and lifting alloy wheel along with the tire, which could be 50 kilo or 60 kilo heavy. And very easily, he's even able to position this. So it's not only lifting and lowering, it is also precise positioning. So we can also think about the nut runners, which are running on this type of manipulators or balancers. So think about this type of devices like nut runners, where you need to position the nut runner precisely in front of that particular object when you want to do the bolting. And this is only because of the digitization, what has been done, the intelligence with which those devices have been equipped with and provided inside. Now coming towards a very special topic, which is new in this industry, which is new in the Indian market, we call it a motion festo, motion terminal. Now the importance of this is that people have been working with pneumatic solutions in the market. Now they have been expecting certain things from the pneumatic. They want a precise positioning. They wanted a flexibility in motion profiles. They wanted overload protection. All these things they were wanting. Maybe with pure pneumatics, it was not happening. Then what they did, they shifted directly to on the left side to the electrical automation, right? Either it could be a servo motor or a stepper motor. Again, the drive will come and all these things will come. Of course, when we go for electric automation, we get a better flexibility in the motion profiles. We can do a lot of complex motions. We can do very precise positioning. All these things possible. But was that necessary? Just because we shifted from pneumatics, because we were not able to get the result the way we wanted, we shifted to electric automation. Why can't we have something which is intermediately available? Now, this is exactly called a motion terminal. And this heading of this, you can see here, it's called a digitized pneumatics. The way it has been equipped with, I'll go into the further slide and explain. Even here also complex motions are possible. It has high functionality. What is that high functionality? We'll see in the later slide. Of course, condition monitoring, predictive maintenance, variable positioning, reduced energy consumption. It is so intelligent and smart that it doesn't allow extra air to go into the devices. And then few components. What is this reduction of these components? Now we'll see in the next slide. As you can see, this is that device called motion terminal. In Festo terminology, it is called motion terminal or VTEM. On the left side, what you see is the conventional pneumatics, right? Now you can see approximately more than 50 components are there to satisfy certain application, because we need a change in the pressure, we need a change in the force, we need a change in the speed, we need some positioning happen on the pneumatic device. Now for that, we need so many components. All that has been now combined on one single block, one single module, which is called a motion terminal, right? And now how this works, it works what you see on the right side. The way today we are so much used to the apps on our mobile phone, it is the WhatsApp or it could be any other app, right? Exactly these devices are working on the motion apps. This you can run through your mobile phone also. This app will run on from your laptop.
Somebody is talking.
Yeah. So the way our mobile phones are equipped with the apps, and then we are running those apps and we are using those day in and day out, it has become the part of our life, our daily routine. The same these motion apps. Now I will explain to you what these motion apps are there. So because of the apps, it has become so easy. Customer knows his application. We only tell, please equip this left one with a particular app. What is this? We'll see in the next slide. Equip the second one with the what you want in your application. Right? Now I will, So this is the device. You can see all so many motion apps. So many motion apps here, right? Now I will take you into a small animation of this device and we'll see. So from the conventional pneumatics to the motion terminal. Thank you. this was how the transformation was happening from the standard and conventional pneumatics to this motion terminal. We will also see one of the apps. As you can see, we have the direction control function. We have the proportional direction control function for different speed of the cylinder. We have proportional pressure regulator function. We have even to the extent that presetting of the travel time. That means you decide the time in what time my device should reach from point A to point B, and the internally the intelligence is provided. Now this is all digitalized technology. It decides on its own. It adjusts its all internal parameters, and we can solve. There is no puppet or no spool. It is based on the piezo technology. Now this is again the new revolution in the field of pneumatics, that we are using the piezo technology for this. So it adjusts all the parameters inside to try to satisfy the preset travel time, what you demand from this device, right? Let us see one of the best apps which is happening and with a lot of customer face problem. This is called a smart soft stop app, right? So you can see conventional pneumatics, you can see the vibrations in the water on the glass, right? So this is happening because of the internal cushioning which is there on the pneumatic cylinder. Now customer didn't want that. So what customer did, he equipped his device with hydraulic shock absorber. You can see this is the hydraulic shock. Hopefully you can see my cursor. So these are the hydraulic shock absorbers on both the ends, and still the application is not getting satisfied the way it is demanded in the machine. Still there are resonances, there are vibrations, and now everything, all physical components are removed, and they were, now the motion app smart soft stop is governing this particular device now, and you can see absolutely vibration free function is happening. So this is the motion terminal. We reduce all the physical devices which were there to stop it smoothly, and plus now the optimization of the cycle time is possible with this, right? Without doing anything, just set the parameters on the device the way we want it, and the device will run exactly the way it is demanded in the application. Coming to a very different topic, which definitely nobody might be aware in the industry. Now people would wonder what is Festo doing in the conveyors, but because we are into the industrial automation, because we are into the factory automation, the part of the industrial automation, so we had to think about this, that only with our own motions, of course we have been automating the motions, we have been governing the motions, and slowly as you saw that we have been digitalizing the motions now. Now that was not enough, right? What about the other technology which is at the other end? What we were doing, it was for somewhere conveyors were used. Now you know that all the conventional and the standard conveyors, what are the big limitations on that? Whether you will get the flexibility in free positioning of each and every carrier? No. Whether you will get the flexibility in varying of the speeds and accelerations on that each and every tray? No. Whether we are able to individually single out each and every carrier because we want to work only on one carrier, the other should wait, they should be in the waiting? No. Right? Whether we will able to group the carriers the way we wanted, two carriers at a time, three carriers at a time, the other should wait? No, it was not possible. Now this exactly is a big leap into the digitalization of the conveyors. How we do it? Of course, in Festo it is called MCS, the multi-carrier system. Some people call it smart conveyors, right? Where free positioning of the carriers is possible, free setting of the speeds and acceleration is possible. Anything what you expect from that. Now we will see a small video animation of that, and you will come to know what we mean. You can see the trays here, how they are being singled out. So the way the components are coming, you can govern those trays. And this power portion, you can see my cursor from this portion to this portion, it is a smart conveyor. The whole loop doesn't require a smart conveyor. There it is a normal conveyor, but only where the portion where the application is going to happen. For example, here the batching application is happening, where maybe the soaps or something of 10 soaps at a time, next time 4 soaps at a time are to be boxed. So this is a typical, it's a packaging system which is used for this. And you can see the singling out of 2 trays or 4 trays, everything is happening with a lot of flexibility. The way they are being governed, the way they are being speeded up, so you can see all these things. So this individualization of each and every carrier on a conveyor is only possible because we have digitized the conveyor. Of course, what is being used are the linear motors at the bottom, And because of the linear motor, this is possible. Now, all this data, of course, through the smart devices and the digitalization of this, again, can be stored into the cloud via all the platforms which I explained earlier. So these are smart controllers from Festo. Now, let me take you to another slide, which is a topic not for today's automation, but definitely for the future automation. Maybe some people might be wondering that what was Festo Bird doing on the YouTube? Some people might have seen a Festo Bird. Some people might have seen an elephant trunk, which you can see on the rightmost corner, bottom corner of my slide. What is this doing? So Festo has now started learning from the nature, learning from the movements of the nature, and try to build this type of technologies through miniaturized automation. You can see why can't multiple objects be gripped with one type of gripper, right? Bird shows, first of all, require extremely light and miniaturized components. So that what we are taking exactly from the nature. How we develop that? You will see in the further slide, adaptive and flexible gripping, miniaturization, communication, networking, right? So we have learned from the chameleon, right, how it can extend its tongue and grip almost anything that component gets stuck to, or that is the insect, would call it component from the industrial point of view, how it gets stuck to its tongue and how it can eat it. Same way the adaptive and flexible gripper can grip almost any object, right? So this is why multiple objects require multiple grippers. Why can't we make a smart gripper, which is an adaptive and highly flexible to grip almost anything, right? That bird shows, here we have shown a small butterfly, that how the miniaturization of the components can be done so that we can make it as light as possible to equip any equipment which requires that miniaturization and lightweight. How we learn from the insects? We know that insects, how they communicate with each other to achieve one single goal of taking a sugar cube from point A to point B, right? So this is what we learn from the insect, the communication. How we can do the networking across the globe, crossing the borders of our country and continent. So this is learned from the butterflies, right? Energy efficiency, how we can transfer the energy from one leg when we are jumping and
sir, we lost your connection. Harsh?
Yes,
this
sir.
Will take the waves through all intelligent devices internally and take this particular device, which is the ball in our case, from point A to point B, right? So this is all the future, and that's why we call it learning from nature for the production of the future. And this is going to be the future, which is again a part of the intelligent and smart devices, and also for the industry 4.0. So these are the future production solutions which are available. Festo has already developed them. Of course, not everything is launched for the commercial purpose as of now, but we are ready with the technology which can cater to and try to satisfy the needs of the industry 4.0. So I'm at the end of my presentation. I thank the audience for patiently listening to me. Something new, something different, what we could deliver today from Festo point of view, and what we are doing for the future, what we are doing for the IoT, what we are doing for the industry 4.0, what type of intelligence and smartness is being the part of the Festo product range for the future production. So I thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mr. Ashwin.
Thanks, Mr. Chandamouli.
We are running out of time, so I request Mr. Harsh Nachnani to look at this one, and there are some interesting questions have come. So we would like to address that. More questions might come now.
Yeah.
So over to Mr. Harsh Nachnani.
Should I click the button stop sharing?
You have to do stop sharing, and okay. Harsh will give him the stop sharing. Over to Mr. Harsh Nachnani. And I think he's going to run in rocket speed. And I have also another engagement at 1:15 I have to run. So I think Mr. Harsh will do the needful.
Sure.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Mr. Vijay Kumar Totad has to switch off his audio, please.
Yeah. Hello?
Vijay Kumar Totad, please switch off his audio, please.
Happy morning, all. Hello, sir. Hello.
Vijay Kumar, please switch off your audio.
Audio. Okay. Done.
No. Your turn will come later. Harish, Mr. Speaker is Harish Nachnani, hello. Please. Harish, please go ahead. Harsh, have you shared the screen to Mr.
Yes, Harish? Sir.
Mr. Nachnani, kindly go ahead, sir.
Sir, I think Harish sir's system has got some issue.
Mr. Ashwin has switched off his thing. Hello.
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Harish, what happened? No. You switch off the Zoom, leave the meeting and come back again. Thank you. Harsh.
Yes, sir.
Request Mr. Some question answer. We can start. There is a problem with technology. Mr. Ashwin. Mr. Ashwin. Hello, Mr. Ashwin. Hello.
Sir, I think there is some issue with Mr. Ashwin also.
Oh, goodness. I don't have his phone number. Even Mr. Ashwin has gone out of the link. He has to come in so that we can at least have the question answer. There is a generic question, I will handle it. Please ensure at least he comes in and closes the session. Maybe the training part we need to have another day. So 1 o'clock we have to have WhatsApp. Mr. Ashwin, please. Otherwise, I will start the Q&A. Thank you. Okay, until Mr. Ashwin comes, we will take some questions. There is a very interesting question from a company in Manesar. Dr. Alka Kaul from Horizon Industrial Products. Harsh, are you able to hear me? Harsh?
Yes, sir. I'm able to hear you,
okay.
Sir.
Okay. Dr. Alka Kaul has sent a very interesting question from Horizon Industrial Products, from Manesar, Nimrana. And they have many, they are into metal forming. That means a lot of metal, sheet metal presses from various companies they have. They also welding machines. So they are in the fabrication industry. And their machines have got CNC controls using Mikuni controls, Japanese controllers, I believe. But they're probably old machines. So she's asking, I'm assuming that it's her. Dr. Alka Kaul is listening, I hope. And she's asking how to automate intelligently with existing legacy machines. This question could be from CNC machining industry, CNC presses, or non-CNC also. And unfortunately, the two great speakers have got a problem with their Festo server. They're all working people, and they're not working out of home. They are in the company. So there must be a server down. And so the LAN must have failed for both of them. And since I know them a little bit, I can pass on this inquiry. It's probably a specific inquiry, but why I'm talking to all of you, the audience, is similar question will arise in your mind. Can we do automation of existing legacy equipment? My answer is partial automation, yes. Full automation, difficult. And more detail, people like Dr. Alka Kaul can share, which will be forwarded by Capital Goods Council to Festo, and answers can be obtained. We can also send to other people in the automation industry to find answers. And in the awareness session is basically to motivate you, not to discourage. Mr. Srini Babu, can you please switch off your video, sir? Not to discourage anybody from old machine, new machine problems. I have worked in machine tool industry in Japanese and German companies. I have seen 20-year-old machines we are able to automate now, even in CNC industry. There are some limitations to it, but with the limitation in understanding and with the budgets available with companies in MSME, such inquiries can be taken up. But that will be a very case-to-case basis. But general answer is, yes, it is possible to with certain limitations. That is an answer to not only Dr. Alka Kaul, but also the other people who have similar question in their mind. There is a question from Sandeep Engineer. Organizer, please take care of technology automation. We are communicating with each other, please. Maybe I think it's a sarcastic comment on what is happening to the internet issues. I'm sure Sandeep also will face internet problem in his home one day. Let's keep the sarcasm out of it. I do agree that Capital Goods Council, also many of them are working out of home. Harsh Chauhan today took all the risk to come to Connaught Plaza and working in his office in the middle of a lockdown, or what is called the containment zone, as we call it in Delhi. I don't see any major other questions in the chat box, but people have to put it in the chat box. I'm not going to receive any verbal questions because they had all the one and a half hours to put their questions. I have received only many points from Dr. Alka Kaul. There is a comment that it's an interesting session, many new ideas. Well, Festo has been in the automation industry for more than 60 years in India and globally also. And recently, they're digitizing all their products, application solutions, and their training division. Mr. Nachnani is unable to connect, unfortunately. It has nothing to do with Capital Goods Council. I am able to talk from home. You're all listening. So all of us are connected through internet. Internet of things means my computer and your computer are both connected through internet, along with the Capital Goods Council. Festo server must have an issue. Sorry for that. MSMEs are grappling with the problem of budget. How much money they can put in the automation and how much money they can put in the digitalization. Automation without digitalization automation with digitalization, and both are important subjects. With or without digital transformation, you can start the automation, and once you are ready with IoT devices, then you can do the digitalization. So when you say the four levels of digital transformation, as Festo showed, is to first make our equipment intelligent. That means adding sensors to the equipment, making them intelligent. The pneumatic devices, hydraulic devices, CNC machines, the making them intelligent is the first step. Then connecting communication. That means the intelligence has to be communicated through protocols and cables and various things, or even through the internet. And finally, networking. That means decentralizing the decision, not at a central place through servers and all, but decentralizing at the equipment level. And of course, along with that goes developing the people. The automation doesn't mean people are going to lose the job. Some of you may have this question in the mind. It's a famous question. It's a very popular question. I confront this question often. And so I can handle that. Yes, at the bottom of the pyramid, labor intensive operations will get minimized. I know in the press tool industry, Dr. Alka Kaul will know, for every press tool, there are three people standing next to the operator. One person is feeding the metal, another person taking out the metal, and third person is trimming the flashes, whatever. One other person is pressing the button for the CNC machine to operate. When you go to Germany and Japan, you don't see that. The same person who is operating also able to do that. Minimal automation, partial minimal automation is enough for feeding metal and taking out the metal. Of course, we want to employ people. Migrant labor is also an issue. So we would like to be very kind to the employment situation in India. But the bottom of the rung in the employment pyramid will obviously disappear. It is already disappearing in automobile industry. It is disappearing in many other industry, food processing industry. We are all getting our food and groceries, beverages to our home now because they are highly automated. Less number of people means less corona effect, less COVID effect. And so we are able to have enjoy the food and beverages at home. Groceries are coming. And through an app, we are able to order from Big Basket and Grofers and Amazon. Every day it's arriving. So there is an internet going on, useful to society at large. Ola is also an example of Internet of Things. But as the jobs are going at a higher level, there are many new jobs are getting created. Factory automation engineer is a new job under whom there will be 10 engineers, small technicians. One will be a pneumatic automation technician. Another will be hydraulic automation technician. Third will be PLC automation technician. So there are several technicians all reporting to factory automation engineer or manager. The title manager engineer in the Western world doesn't matter. A manager doing engineering job is as good as an engineer. But because he's got 10 technicians, he's also managing those people. So there is a management role played by the engineer. So as a factory automation engineer, he's also a factory automation manager. And as Mr. Ashwin presented, there are a lot of roles which are coming in predictive maintenance. He talked about predictive maintenance and app development. He's talking about a mobile app. The mobile app, what he means is a different concept from our mobile phone app. Don't get mixed up between the mobile app, what Ashwin presented, and the mobile phone apps we are talking about. Well, so there are many new jobs are getting created. App development is a new role. Data analytics is a new role. Artificial intelligence is nothing but understanding the current situation and the past situation and predicting the future using algorithms. So those who make software algorithm is a new job. So in like in any, over the last 100 years, many jobs vanished in this world. The steam engine vanished. So people who manufacture steam engines are gone. But diesel engines came up. Then electrical railway came up. So new jobs created. So automation is to enable the human being. It is not to replace the human being. So that is a question which running in your mind and trying to fill the time when the speakers have vanished.
I am really very sorry to interrupt in between. I think Mr. Harish is online with us.
Okay, Mr. Yes. Harish.
Yes. Yeah, sorry. I think it was a network issue. And Ashwin is also having a challenge now.
So working out of home is better sometimes.
Okay. Yeah. Yes. So in yes, paucity sir, of time, what,
please go ahead. Go ahead.
No, how should we manage? Because
sir, you got 20 minutes.
Okay.
I answered the only question which I received.
Okay.
And I think Dr. Alka Kaul is happy. She has given the email address, which I'll pass it on to you. And
yeah.
Council, and it is in the chat box. Dr. Subha Bangare, who's in the plastic industry, is our group, our general council member in Capital Goods Council. And he has got a lot of thoughts on this, and he is going to do a webinar himself. Other than that, I don't see any interesting questions from anybody. And
Hello.
So I leave Hello. It to Mr. Harish Nachnani, who is heading the didactic training division, to speak about the training of Festo. Please, Mr. Harish.
Yep. Hello. Hello.
Hello, Harish sir.
Yeah.
Sir, do you also have any presentation?
Yes, I have a presentation here.
You have 20 minutes to go, sir. I'll keep answering the people on the chat box. Mr. Durgesh Mishra has asked something. I will answer him. Not a worry.
Can you give me the share screen option?
Yes, sir. That is already given to you, sir.
Okay. Was not sharing.
Yeah, now we are sharing.
It is coming, sir.
Yeah.
20 minutes.
Okay.
30 participants have left. They must be busy. They must be hungry.
Yeah, sure.
But I don't know what happened to Ashwin. Can other people mute? Arsh, can you mute the others?
Yes, I will do that, sir.
Why should you not do it every time? Mr. Pratik Agarwal, I think, is very adamant. He's always talking. I don't know why.
Okay. Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Harish Nachnani. I head the didactic at Festo India. So we have run into technology issues, which is quite normal these days to have. I will rush through the presentation. My idea was to give you a very quick overview on Festo Didactic. We talk about why digitization, why we try to look at the mega trends. How the human factor is important when we go towards smart manufacturing, some sort of dilemmas of our technical qualification and what Festo has been doing and what Festo can support in terms of Industry 4.0. You had a quick overview of Festo from my colleague. One thing just I can highlight is Festo Didactic is a separate company in Germany since 1965. And we are offering learning and training solutions since 1965. One side of it. Of course, what we do from Didactic is, of course, we have the education part where we handle a lot of equipments and solutions around the training equipments, where we offer training to the industry, to the institutes. And also we do a lot of qualification, you know, in terms of in-house qualification, wherein we run certain long-term programs like German dual vocational education, which has been worldwide recognized as one of the best offerings for VET segment. And that is where we also pioneer and we ourselves run this program, even in India, Germany, China, US, Italy, and in many countries. In terms of automation, people, as my colleague Ashwin shared, people were relating Festo to pneumatic. Then they started looking at Festo for process automation, also for last decade, maybe for also automation. But when it comes to the didactic part is, you know, we have a further enlarged offering, a further holistic offering, if I may put it, covering the different topics and that we have been doing it for more than last 50 years, you know, in terms of topics covering like electronics. And when I say electronics, it could just a normal analog digital to even radar technology, you know? So that kind of a diverse. So if you see a very quick product range starting from the fundamentals, standalone technologies of say, pneumatic hydraulics, or with PLC, mechatronic systems, mobile robot, electrical, electronics. We do a lot of things under renewable energy as a holistic offering that we do, and also covering topics of like industrial maintenance. And when we go into mechatronics, of course, we cover it up to Industry 4.0 with basic, advanced, and expert levels. Digital learning is very, very important these days. And that's what my idea was to cover a little later, a part of digital learning and a special a new offering from Festo, what we say now, a Festo learning experience. So if time permits, I will rush through that part. Festo, in our training centers in India, we also offer different training courses covering pneumatic, hydraulics, PLC, mechatronics, and also Industry 4.0. We run it through our world-class training centers across the country that we have, a very small glimpse that you can see. And what we really define is our goal and expertise, you know, is to improve the competences for tomorrow's companies, you know, to prepare the companies for tomorrow. That's what we say. And that's why we say call ourselves as the engineers of productivity. Now, why digitalization matters? You know, yes, everything that can be digitalized will be digitalized. Everything that can be connected will be connected. Everything that can be automated will be automated. You know, and then that's how we have the need for digitalization. Moving into the era of Industry 4.0, where we need or we want to have a seamless integration from top to shop floor, you know, connecting on a ground level between machine-to-machine communication or a real-time communication from the shop floor to the top floor, covering connecting to the ERP or the supply chain management or PLM tools. And that's how we say the need for digitization. And also some of the mega trends some we have already seen, like 3D printing and all.
Harish, you can show your video account. You can show Harish.
Sorry?
They would like to see who you are.
Okay.
Show your video.
Sure. I do that. Okay. And topics like autonomous driving, artificial intelligence. So we are already seeing for the last few years, you know, these trends are there. And what is happening with these trends? My screen is fixed. Yeah, and also a big question what everybody asks, you know, whether with such automation, such new topics, you know, whether we'll lose jobs, you know. So what we say from our side, you know, jobs will not be lost. Jobs will not be replaced, but activities will be. You know, when it is an autonomous driving, maybe the driver is not sitting inside the car, but at least he's there somewhere in the cloud, you know, and operating the device. A trainer, which may not be face-to-face, a meeting that we could have done face-to-face, we are doing it over web today. And so the activities will change. The operator will have to be there on the shop floor to manage the machines. But the way he would do it, the way the tools that he would use, that's what's going to change, you know, and that's what we have. And therefore, digitalization means a fundamental change. You know, it's a change in the value system. It's in the life cycle of the product itself. You know, and that is what it is driving. That blending the virtual and the real world together, and that's a part which is going to be more and more, in our opinion, moving forward. And therefore, why we say Industry 4.0 will have effect on all areas of training. You know? When we go into a digitization of the working environment, the roles, the job profiles of each of the human working on the shop floor or in the industry or this industry would change. And then we would need to look at his academic training. We need to look at his professional training. And a very, very important point, we need to look at his fundamental and continuing learning. You know? For example, in economies, we don't have such a challenge in India, but if we see in economies like Japan, Germany, where the manpower is the age is on the higher side, and therefore they have to be taught skills, even like how to use, even say, a tablet on a shop floor. Yeah, so a lot of things are changing, and that's why we say The human factor is one of the most important topics that we need to address during the Industry 4.0 part of it. And then there's, yes, a lot of dilemmas when it comes to technical qualification. A lot of new words will come: cyber physical systems, smart maintenance, Internet of Things. Of course, part is there. But then what is behind each term, you know, of Industry 4.0? You know, how to integrate new products and technologies? You know, which kind of qualifications are needed? Which kind of new technologies will, how long will they be valid? You know? So many such thinking of dilemmas come. And if you see on the other side of dilemma is also the gap between the larger companies and the SME. You know? It's like larger companies have more of the tools available with them, more of the resources available with them, that they can look at little future, they can look at planning for the future in terms of competency requirement, in terms of technologies that can be adopted, and how at an SME level, how we can pass on more such kind of information to them that they can be prepared for the future. So there are a lot of dilemmas around that technical qualification, and that's what we need to address. And that's where a company like Festo, with its professional solutions in qualification and consulting, like we try to prepare a qualification 4.0 program for an industry, define different kind of training courses and learning systems available to showcase that, how we can plan the internal skills training and development, and offer a consulting solution to an industry. And this how we really from the point is, in one terms, a lot of intelligent products, which again my colleague shared, that can be used towards Industry 4.0 implementation. We can show a lot of best practices from Festo that we have been doing it globally and also in India. We learn from the learning systems and learning environments that we can create with us, training offering that we have, which can lead to a qualification of people. And this is how Festo can be a helper. And what we have is facility and how we can learn from our manufacturing facilities. For example, a facility in Germany, Schönhausen, which is fully functional on Industry 4.0 application. That's one part of it. But it also has a practical training factory inside the plant itself. You know, and this practical training factory is making learning as a part of the process. And that is what we always say from the Festo side, is learning as a part of a process that way. Yeah? So some of the best practices within our plant, whether it is energy management or traceability of component or OEE. So a lot of things that what we do from Festo, we can support from our side. Way. And also how we bring in the expertise. You know, we all know industry topic coming in from Germany, the government of Germany driving it maybe since 2011-12, and since then we have been supporting the different initiatives, being part of different steering committees, being founding different associations, working with different chambers in Germany, or being part and involvement with agencies like the protocol, the OPC UA, the involvement with a Smart Factory Association, and then different kind of chambers in Germany. And that is where we share our learnings, experience, and also help each other in preparing for the future. In terms of Industry 4.0 qualification programs from Festo, yes, what we really push and talk about is the practical-based training. That's the most important part from our side. What we do is the hands-on training on industry-based equipment. And then, of course, when it comes to Industry 4.0, it could be the Industry 4.0 introduction or the core elements of Industry 4.0, and also going to the smart manufacturing. And in comes with a very, very basic, what we start is in terms of real digitization, what we do and how we talk about in training is how we can increase the efficiency production and how digitization can improve the efficiency, you know, how we can have breakdowns as soon as possible, recover from breakdowns as soon as possible, prevent the future breakdowns, see the energy state and control the, or how we can move the side of it. Yeah. So, and that's how we come up with different training offerings. And just one example, a small of how we can have a smart maintenance task just for the upskilling part of it. Like there was a question of how we can have existing plant, existing machinery connected to the cloud using the smart products, using collecting information from the field sensors. Through the complete video because we have a lot of paucity on time. That's why I'm also rushing in my talks. Coming to the next stage of how we can have a practical based learning approach, what we say, and that's all we talk about the different components of Industry 4.0, whether we are going to demonstrate augmented reality or the MES system, or how we are using RFID into the system, or how we have machine to machine communication. And this is all what is important for to prepare the workforce for tomorrow, when we say. And hands-on learning, the group learning, that's what we always emphasize on, which is highly interactive in nature. And also can really go from an integrated, modular, and expandable learning for Industry 4.0. And that's how we say, starting from an application module to a lab module to a combination of lab combination, and to going to a phase of smart manufacturing. Okay. Then again, we have a video on our offering. Just a second. What we are offering of the cyber physical lab. Again, it's in terms of how flexible an application module is today, that's very important, how modular it is, and how the systems are really plug and play. That's one of the most important parts of Industry 4.0, to have the standardized interfaces. So how we can change.
The video stopped. Harish sir, video stopped. You also disappeared. Okay. Mr. Harish Chauhan?
Yes, sir.
I think it's 1 o'clock, so you seem to automatically set it for closing, or I'm just being humorous. Mr. Harish, your video stopped and you also disappeared.
No, I'm very much there.
You came in. You came in now, but the video stopped all abruptly.
Maybe the...
Some problem. So I think what
no,
is...
I think what I'm getting a message is post disabled participant screening option. So...
Harsh? Chavan?
Yes, sir.
Why did you disable?
Not from my side, sir.
I'm getting a message post disabled participant screening sharing.
Harsh, galat se kiya kya?
Not at all, sir. In fact, just give me a second. Let me see.
No, Harsh, can you go ahead then? Is it possible to enter the screen now?
Sir, can you please check now, Harish, sir?
Hello.
No,
Harish, video also is frozen. It's 1 o'clock now, so I think. Did you set up any time limit? 1 o'clock, it should automatically switch up. Harsh.
Sir, we have taken it for 2 hours, so 11 to 1 we have taken.
What do you mean by taken? That means is it automatically switching it off? But the 56 participants are still there.
Yes, sir.
No, it is not closed.
Sir, in fact, Harish sir has left. He got some issue with his system, I believe.
Okay, I think to respect Mr. Ashwin.
Yes, I am there. I am there. Mr. Chandramouli, I am there.
What happened?
No. We had the LAN problem, and myself and Harish, we are both in the office because of this, we get a better speed. But unfortunately, there was a LAN problem. So now we have switched on to our mobile phones. So that's why his videos were not working well. And he might have now got some another problem.
Your video also was slow in the morning.
Okay. But I was on land.
Anyway, I think we had a good program.
Yeah.
Your program was very good because you could complete it.
Yeah.
Harish could not complete because he came late, and then he also had a problem. And then that's okay. It all part of the parcel.
Yeah.
Now it's 1 o'clock. So Capital Goods Council has a rule that, you know, they don't want to hold the audience too long.
Yeah.
Normally we do 1.5 hours, but because there are two speakers, I provided for 2 hours.
Okay.
And after my initial introduction, 1.5 hours.
Yeah.
So Q&A, I answered many of them in the chat box. Okay. And one big question has come from Dr. Alka, which may be interesting for all of us. Mm-hmm. These two, which has been answered by me on your behalf.
Okay.
Basically on legacy machines, they are into press tools and they are into welding. They want to convert their legacy machines to automation and digitalization.
Okay.
As I said, it is possible with certain limitations, and we can address it. They are given their email address. It is there in the chat box.
Yeah.
And I will ask Harsh Chavan to take out that portion and send it to you.
Maybe people you can give my email ID to them. People can also contact
me. Yeah. They got all the email address of, not yours, but next time around, you know, we should give the speaker email also.
Yeah.
But suffice to say that many of the other questions were very specific, and they were answered through the thing. And we are anyway giving awareness of knowledge. We are not looking at the festo of the brand, which we have to emphasize very clearly. We are giving the knowledge that what is happening in the rest of the world, like a European world or Western world or whatever.
Yeah.
And conversion of legacy machine was a concern. MSMEs, see, mostly in these programs, what happens is the OEMs very seldom participate.
Okay.
The MSMEs and the universities are participating because they want education, more of education.
Okay.
So it is not the sales process, but it is more of the education process.
Yeah.
Sales process examples are used to educate rather than the other way around.
Right.
And I take this opportunity to thank Mr. Ashwin, Mr. Harish, who has disappeared due to the land problem.
Yeah.
And Capital Goods Council, Ms. Shalini is still on there. She is a COO of the, and she has very happily offered the support of Capital Goods Council, not only for skilling, but also even placement.
Yeah.
She is writing, if people have any manpower problem, they can write to CGSE. There is a pool of people who've been trained by this 896 training partners, waiting for jobs. So the connection between job seekers and recruiters is not happening.
Correct.
And Apprenticeship Act has been handed over to skill councils. It is no more the apprenticeship department.
Okay.
Apprenticeship Act has been handed over to Capital Goods Council, Aerospace Council, like that.
Okay.
So it is not a full-fledged employment exchange bureau, but to some extent, we are trying to help. The participants are listening. Could be students, right. Could be executives working. But we are not people who are headhunting. So they should not say that, I'm working here, can you change the job to another? That's different. We are talking about really job seekers who are really affected by the corona.
Right.
Especially the migrant labor. And Shalini is doing a great job on connecting job seekers and job placers.
Correct.
And I'm sure Festo also doing a lot of good work on Apprenticeship Act.
Yeah.
And across your 6 training centers and your own big factory in India, there is a lot of training going on. Some are paid, some are charge free, etc. And thank you so much, Mr. Ashwin.
On behalf of Festo and Harish Nathani, yes, I would like to thank CGSE,
yes,
for organizing this and giving us an opportunity that we could share something, what is happening today, what is the trend of the technology, and what is the trend of the future production also. So thank you very much, Mr. Chandramouli. Thanks, Mr. Harish.
Yes, sir.
And next time we'll see on which platform we meet, and then we can also deliver something more and different.
No, we are going to have a follow-up activity, I want to inform you, which will be paid training program.
Okay.
And there we hope to have perfect technology, LAN, etc. And both the host or the sharing people, we need very good technology.
Okay.
The videos are going slowly. So again, it's due to the speed differences. And I have a LAN which is 100 Mbps. You can see here. My LAN is here. 100 Mbps.
Right.
I deliver a lot of webinars. People say videos are running fast. No issue.
Mm-hmm.
And the workshops, I requested Mr. Harish Nachnani,
okay,
will be focused workshop with simulation software.
Okay.
Siras, for example. Or Fluid Sim, for example. And maybe a little later, CPS and all will come in. But basic PLC training and all those things, we have to kickstart.
Right.
And that's in the offing.
Right.
And when that happens, Festo, you are also GC member of our council, will play a major role on this.
Yeah, sure.
And Department of Heavy Industries is looking to international players like you to support the government initiative on smart manufacturing.
Yeah, sure, definitely.
On that note, I would like to thank one of our GC members is listening to us, Mr. Subha Bangare. He is from the plastic industry. He is the head of the Plastic Industry Association, PMMAI, they call it. And he has asked many questions, and I answered it privately. He has written to me today on the chat box.
Yeah.
Nothing to do with Festo or pneumatics or anything, just general questions.
Mm-hmm.
And he will also be doing a webinar.
Okay.
On not only on behalf of plastic industry, but also it is part of the capital goods course.
Okay.
But our focus is not only technology, it is people.
Yeah.
Both knowledge and practicals for the people.
Correct.
Thank you so much, Harsh. Thank you so much,
Harish.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ashwin, for doing a wonderful webinar for 2 hours. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Harsh. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Yantanapalli. I think he's from my university. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Yeah.
Mr. Subha Bangaru, you want to say a few words? Your audio is off. Subha, audio is off.
Yeah.
Ms. Preeti Singh, is audio is off.
Yeah. Now you can hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I'll have to rush, but...
Yeah, just 1 minute. I think, you know, we have to make it as an educative sessions all through, because, I mean, you know, when you talk about future is automation, future is... We still have in our workforce a lot of people who have been trained in the old concept. I think it's time that in all industry, veterans, specialists come together and make training as much as possible. It's not coming from an institute, not coming from an association like this. This is my viewpoint. Generally, I think you already said it earlier. I just added what you said.
No, my point is that we can take up such feedback offline. Today, the question answer is addressed to the topic delivered.
Mm.
And we respectfully ask questions related to the topic delivered.
Mm.
And we will take up the feedback session through the Capital Goods Council, and we will improve upon it. I already answered you privately.
Yeah.
But I would like to officially close the webinar now. Mm. So therefore, we need to leave the session. And then we can take this discussion offline, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
Respectfully.
Harish has also joined now. So you can see his video.
Yeah, Harish, no, the members, only 30 members are there.
Okay.
We will handle a separate session for Harish. And he wanted 45 minutes, but we couldn't give him that.
Okay.
And Harish will do a separate training session using simulation software, etc. We did earlier for a regional chamber. We'll do for national chamber very soon in August or September. We will also do for the plastic industry in August. And we have, luckily, you know, Corona is still waiting to go. So we have six more months. And so there should be at least six more webinars on behalf of CGSC.
Yeah.
But on behalf of other chambers, I'm doing many, many webinars. And this message is spreading. Message is spreading. C4I4 is doing a webinar almost every week. FSM is doing a webinar almost every week.
Okay.
These are all from Samarth Udyog centers.
Mm-hmm.
And Indian Institute of Science is doing a webinar every week. Okay. Madras Management Association is doing 4 webinars per day.
Oh.
4 webinars per day.
Bangalore
Chamber of Bangalore Chamber of Industry and Commerce is doing at least 2 webinars per week. So CIA is doing a webinar every day across the country. Okay. So webinars are webinars. So, but workshops and training workshops, when people pay the fee, it will be very serious, both from the student point of view and also from the speaker point of view, and the technology like internet has to cooperate. So I humbly submit that these are all learning for all of us. And what we could not do physically, we are trying to do virtually. And Festo, I really thank you for your great work on training and development across the world and across India.
Yeah.
On that note, I want to officially close the session now, because the session is supposed to close at 1 o'clock. Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'll be the last one to close. So trying to close your individual screens.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Harish.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Harish.
Thank you, Mr. Thank you.